Coral. Litta Naid, better known to some as Coral, was a sorceress from Skellige. However, let's first go back to her name. Litta Naid isn't her real name, but the name that everyone uses for her, since her real name is too long and too complicated for most people to pronounce. So I'm just gonna try to pronounce it, and I'm probably gonna fail. Astrid Lidnaids Askir Fiends Björns Dottir. It's understandable why people call her Litta Naid or Coral instead of her full name. As I'm still talking about the name, let's talk about her nickname, Coral. The name Coral refers to the color of her favorite lipstick, the one she always wears. You might have thought that had to do with something like the ocean or the Skellige origins, however, the name is just lipstick and nothing more. Talking about the Skellige origins, let's start with her history. Coral was born on the Isles. She's one of the very few well-known talented sorceresses from Skellige. Her origin is very important to her, and from a young age, the ocean has been calling to her. Or how she puts it in Season of Storms. The sea is in my blood, and I love it. I dream of sailing away one day, she continued when he remained silent. All alone, set sail and put out to sea, far, far away, and all the way to the horizon. Only waters and sky all around. The salt foam splashes me. The wind tucks my hair in an utterly male caress. And I am alone. Completely alone. Endlessly alone among the strange and hostile elements. Solitude amidst a sea of strangeness. Don't you dream of that? No, I don't, he thought. I have it every day. At some point during her youth, before she became a sorceress, Coral was a naturally curly redhead with freckles. During her studies at Arethusa, she removed her freckles, seeing it as an imperfection that sorceresses shouldn't have. However, what she didn't remove was her tattoo. On her hip, Coral has a tattoo of an anglerfish. Not an angler fish, but an anglerfish. I'll put an image of it on the screen. A type of fish that, during her youth, was something only the very rich could afford, and was kind of fashionable. However, this fish later became associated with the snobbish rich people, and it went out of fashion. However, she never removed it, because it was a memento to her youth on the islands. During her time at Arethusa, she specialized in using forms of magic that involve water. Of course, she was also able to use other spells, for example, to teleport or artificially compress someone. However, she mainly focused on water-related magic. After her studies, Coral started working. She mainly focused on providing abortions to pregnant women who didn't want to have a child, or to treat infertility. As all along the coast, there were people, which meant women, and that meant there was no shortage of clients for her. And she made a lot of coin this way. Litta seemed to have been very social with the other magic users in the north. She even partook in the bets that they placed on how long the mages thought Geralt and Yennefer would last together. She managed to win this bet, and with that all the coin they placed in. In the year 1245, Litta was asked by the mages at Risburg to send the witcher Geralt of Rivia their way because they were in need of a monster slayer, and Geralt had gained quite a reputation. She could have just told Geralt about the job, and he would have accepted. However, as sorceresses wanted to do often, she decided to show her power. Sometime before Geralt arrived in Carrack, Litta met with the king Bellohun. She stayed in Carrack for some time to act as an advisor to Bellohun. However, he had one demand. That if his future bride were to come to her for an abortion, that she would refuse. Litta agreed. However, before she left, she told the king that Geralt had embezzled funds from the royal purse. This, however, was misinformation. Geralt, however, did get arrested as soon as he arrived in Carrack. After 4 days of imprisonment, he was released on bail, paid by Coral. She just wanted Geralt to know her power and influence. Geralt went to talk to her at the villa. He thought he would be smart by trying to act as though he wasn't interested in Coral, and that he instead pretended to like her apprentice, Mosaic, more than Coral herself. Just like almost all other sorceresses, Coral couldn't stand it that Geralt had given her apprentice all the attention, and not her. Out of anger, after Geralt had left, she turned one of Mosaic's hands around, which made it face the wrong direction. After a few days, she would fix this once again. Geralt learned of this while he encountered Mosaic at the marketplace. As soon as he knew, he went off to talk to Coral. However, this time he was more careful. On the way, he picked a freesia flower. The scent of this flower, along with apricots, was the scent of Coral's perfume. He presented this flower to Coral as to apologize, and she accepted. She asked if he knew the meaning of the flower, to which it seemed like Geralt didn't know. So, if you wonder what a freesia means, it stands for innocence and friendship. It was never discussed in Season of Storms, so I just decided to put that in. Coral, in turn, decided to give Geralt a different kind of gift by undressing herself. They spent 4 days together in bed. On the first day, Coral never let go of the flower she had received from him. One thing to note here is that Geralt never really had any feelings for her. Even though he's naturally attracted to red-haired women, as he discusses in his own thoughts, he still only felt something for Yennefer. Coral's feelings towards Geralt, however, are a bit different. On the one side, we get insight in the things she values the most in men from her years of trying and testing. In her opinion, a real man was an enthusiastic angler, but only using a fly. He collects military figurines, erotic prints, and models of sailing ships he built himself. There would never be a shortage of empty, expensive alcoholic bottles in his home. He would also be a great cook, able to prepare culinary masterpieces. And above all, the sight of him had to be enough for her to desire him. And Geralt fulfilled at least one requirement. Later, during their 4 day bed adventure, speaking of which that bed was said to be as large as the deck of a frigate, she had the following thought. Perhaps model sailing ships too, thought Coral chaotically, trying to control her rapid breathing. Perhaps military figurines too. Perhaps fly fishing. But what counts, what really counts, is the way he holds me. Geralt embraces her, as though she were all the world to him. On the other side, she seemed to want to do this to annoy Yennefer, who really doesn't seem to care, as she knows Geralt only loves her, and had no real feelings for Coral. However, getting back to her story, after the days she spent with Geralt, she had to get back to work with the abortions. Around this time, Geralt started to look for a sword, which he had lost once again. Eventually, he decided to ask Coral for help. Coral used divination magic to show the future in the water inside the fountain in her villa. This, however, showed him several events that were going to happen soon, all related to Geralt's adventures in Season of Storms, except the final image. He saw a sea of grass, a boundless plain reaching to the horizon. He saw it from above, as though from a bird's eye view, or from the top of a hill. A hill whose slopes descended in a row of vague shapes. When they turned their heads, he saw unmoving faces, unseeing, dead eyes. They are dead, he suddenly realized. It's a cortege of the dead. Lita's fingers squeezed his hand again, with the strength of pliers. A flash of lightning, a sudden gust of wind, tugged at the hair. Geralt breathed out heavily and stood up. "Right at the end," he muttered, helping Sorcerer stand up. "That last image, the hill, that procession of people. I didn't recognize it. I have no idea what it could be." "Neither do I," she answered in an uneasy voice. "But it wasn't your vision. That image was meant for me. I have no idea what it could mean either. But I have a strange feeling there's nothing good in it." Geralt followed the trail a bit that he had seen in the visions. However, he returned soon empty-handed. Coral, on the other end, thought that it was now time to fulfill what she was asked to do by the sorcerers of Risberg. In exchange for her contributions in his search, he agreed to take the job at Risberg, where he met with Algernon Gwynnkamp, nicknamed Pinnity. He is a sorcerer and former lover of Lita Nade. He also at some point in the past was rumored to have a fling with Sabrina Glevesick. For the sake of this video's length, as well as because she doesn't appear for some time in the books, I'm skipping ahead for like a month. Geralt hasn't found his swords and arrived back at Carrick, just in time for the wedding of the king, where he was tasked to protect him by one of his sons. As the king had many legitimate and illegitimate sons, and there was kind of a scrabble going on for who will get the throne. Once Geralt saw Coral and Mosaic, Coral told them that Mosaic had won a bet on whether or not Geralt would return. Coral expected him to never return. However, he was there, and she informed him on the things that had happened at Risberg as consequences of Geralt's actions. She and Geralt talked for a while, when Mosaic and Dandelion left for a short moment. She decided to end the relationship, to let it go and fade into a pleasant memory. Although at first, a month prior, when they last saw each other, she wouldn't have called it that. However, their ways didn't split yet. As the wedding was getting started, Coral recognized the bride as Idilico Breckel, a former student from Aretusa, was thrown out in the third year because of petty theft. However, that wasn't all. As a ship named the Argerontia had just entered the harbor, a ship Coral recognized, thanks to her expertise when it came to ships. This ship was known to carry mercenaries, and that wasn't a good sign. Geralt went out to learn more, and to sum up some of the following events, the Prince of Carrick that hired Geralt wanted to kill his father. He failed and was arrested. The mercenary ship had the king's eldest son on board, who was banished a long time ago. The king got a wedding gift from his bride, a necklace. The necklace strangled him to death with magic. And then the eldest son, the one which was banished and came back with the mercenaries, came into the room pronouncing himself the new king of Carrick and to take his father's bride as his own wife. This part has to be told for some more context later on. Okay, back to Coral. Rats started running from the lower part of the city, towards the higher part of the town. Although the sky was clear, they, as well as Coral, knew that there was a storm approaching. The storm suddenly hit the city, and Coral told Geralt that they had to get away from the city as soon as possible. However, Geralt refused to leave. Coral teleports away by herself, leaving Mosaic, Dandelion, and Geralt, because they didn't want to abandon the people. Half the city got destroyed. Enormous waves killed hundreds of inhabitants of Carrick. And Geralt, when he saw three children on a roof floating in the water, jumped right in to try and save them. He was helped by a woman, who was the daughter of a crime lord. However, she drowned right after she helped with the children to shore. The storm went away as quickly as it came. Coral had returned as well, with a medicine bag. However, Geralt was angry. She claimed that she had left to get her stuff to help. However, Geralt was convinced that she just left to protect herself, and didn't care about the others. Coral wasn't happy with what he said, and stormed off to help the wounded. the memory of her relationship with Geralt becoming one without much joy. They never met each other again. Geralt went on to Temeria after he heard about the contract with the Strega. Coral left Carrack about 2 weeks after the storm. Yennefer came to visit her just before, and they talked to each other like friends. At least, more friendly than Yennefer would have talked with Sabrina. Coral tried to play a prank on Yennefer by pretending she was pregnant, as Coral did not only treat abortions but infertility as well. So Yennefer for a short moment was scared that Coral was actually pregnant with the child of Geralt, which would have been weird. But so yeah. However, she soon talked about different things, like why she was leaving Carrack. The new king, Phyrexus, had decided that magic wasn't allowed in his kingdom unless you had a permit for which you had to pay. Also, mages weren't allowed to have property in the small kingdom. As such, she decided to leave. Her apprentice, Mosaic, who had ran off with Geralt, had returned to her not long before that, because Geralt asked her in a letter that he left on her bed at an inn to return to Coral to finish her studies, as that is what would have been the best for her. Coral was surprised when she heard that Geralt had sent her back. Yennefer, however, not so much. "He ordered you to return to me," said Lyta Ned. "He ordered you to return, although you could imagine what might be awaiting you. I must admit, I'd never have expected that of him." "I find it astonishing," Lyta repeated. "I never have expected it of him." "Because you didn't know him, Coral," Yennefer replied calmly. "You didn't know him at all." In the following years, Coral presumably moved between cities and kingdoms along the coast, with Mosaic by her side, until she had finished her education. However, that isn't yet the end of her story, as the hill from her vision still calls towards her. About 18 years later, she learned what her vision had meant. Nilfgaard had invaded Sintra, and the North united at the Battle of Sudden Hill. The mages stood on top of the hill to defend the North against the invader. Thanks to their efforts, the North was safe, at least for a few years. The battle, however, came at a high cost. 13 sorceresses had died. Their names were carved into the stone obelisk on the hill to commemorate their deaths. Also, it's called 14, but one survived, so that's why I said 13. Among the dead was Coral. She died screaming, having lost her legs and her arms. However, that wasn't the last thing we heard about her. In The Lady of the Lake, when at the end they say goodbye to the fallen in a mist, they could see people dear to them who had died. Triss here smelled something. The scent of Lyta Nade's perfume. Lyta Nade, the sorceress who wanted to sail away from everything, to be one with the ocean, had met her death at the Hill of the 14. Far away from the ocean. That was it for Lyta Nade. However, I wanted to mention a few things. Throughout Season of Storms, there's been given kind of a suggestion that Lyta isn't as cold-hearted and bitchy as she would make out to be, as she would seem to be. As Geralt at some point notices and calls her sweet, and that scares her, because she feels like Geralt could see through her facade and see who she really was. Also, I want to mention that there is a theory about her that I will upload soon as well. As a quick mention after the video, she will appear in Netflix Witcher series. And to be fair, I won't expect much people to be not satisfied with our actress looks. I'll put an image on screen. If you liked the video, press the like button and subscribe if you're new. It means a lot to me. Also, in the last chapter of Season of Storms where she appears, she's described as looking like a September evening. And currently the month is September, so that fits nicely. For some reason, it seems like CD Projekt Red really hated Coral, as the way they described her in The Witcher 3 just seemed very cold-hearted and like an awful person. Even though it's weird that it's Triss who says she doesn't like Coral, even though she's supposed to have a certain type of relation with Coral, and is like the only person who mentions Coral up until like the Lady of the Lake. That was it for Lit and Nate. Till next video. Bye.